It's not my best.
Oh, okay. I will start up when the music stops. When the music stops. Well, good morning, everyone. Are you cued into what we're doing here this morning? That's right. I love the sweet, sweet sound of horns in the morning. You know, we had a beautiful service in Dent inside the building this morning. It was glorious. It was beautiful. We needed it. And I just want you to know that is where we are headed next Sunday. Next Sunday, September 20th, we are going to meet in our building. Hi, Carmen's hooting. Woohoo! Any more hoots? Hoots, hoots. Woohoo! Honk your horns. Yes! Dear friends, we need to see each other. We need to worship together. And I just want to share with you, we're going to be talking about this quite a bit this morning, but Dent did it very, very safely. And I was nervous. I was like, I'm going to pull the plug on this thing if they are not safe. They didn't know that. I knew that. But they were very respectful and compliant. And I think in a couple weeks, we're just going to get used to it and we'll just move ahead. So this is my word to you, please. Come next week, come early, because you're going to more than likely, 100%, you will be sitting in a different spot than what you're used to sitting in. So you're going to have to, you know, start grieving that now and then get over yourself. And come to church on Sunday. And this was a fun thing I learned about worship in Dent. We can't sing, but they hummed. Those little rebellious people. But the humming was precious. It was beautiful. And by the second hymn, I said, let's hum our hearts out, folks. And so we're humming and it's muffled, but we did it and we were proud and we worshiped God and it was good. So I am kind of at the end of my rope and being happy with this. I am ready for a change and I hope you are too. And I am more ready than ever to get ourselves ready for when this pandemic is over, we get a vaccine, it goes to the moon, I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen, but there will be a day we will get through this, and we have things we need to do to get ready for that. So I am eager to get working on things. And I think it makes a little bit more sense for me this morning as I stand here, as I think about how God has been guiding us into this next sermon series based on surrender. We need to surrender. We need to just get over it. Nobody likes this pandemic. Nobody likes wearing a mask, a face mask, and standing 6 feet apart. But we're going to be okay, right? We're going to just be patient. We're going to get through this. And amen. Who said that? Thank you, Lana. Good to see you this morning. So surrendering. I've talked about this before. Surrendering. Being a person that can surrender is an essential spiritual discipline. It is an essential muscle we need to exercise every day as we follow God. We surrender our wills so that we can be lights in a dark place. We surrender our wills as we come together in community. As not my will, but your will be done. The Lord said this to the Heavenly Father. So we need to learn more about this. And surrendering is never easy. It's never easy. I get it. But it can be made a little bit easier, perhaps, when we remember that our God is the one who knows us intimately and has good plans for us. That is where we're headed this morning. So let us now join in our call to worship, found in your worship bulletin. Let us begin our worship. God of Ruth and Naomi.
God of Boaz, Obed, David, and
wilderness, of life in death, on the feet, on the backs, on the lives of women and men, you, Lord, are born in our resistance to injustice, and you shoulder with all the burden of poverty and doubt. Lead us into the good plans you have for us that give us hope and a future. Amen. As we now continue our worship, as we engage with our opening prayer, again, I want to reiterate this and communicate this. This is going to be a theme that I'm going to stick with for a while, but I have felt led by God the last few months to get us back on track with breakthrough prayer. Very simple. It's praying twice a day. We printed cards and we arbitrarily picked 9:02 a.m. and 9:02 p.m. Pick whatever works for you. But now let us be united as a church. Let us be united in prayer, inviting God to do things that only He can do. And we want Him to move in our midst. We want God to do new things, bring new life, develop and expand new vision for ministry. We are not down and out. We are up and rising in the power of God. So I encourage you, pray. You can do it. I'm doing it. Join me. Pick a time and pray for God to move, and we will give God all the glory. So let us now engage with our opening prayer for a season as we are in surrender. Our breakthrough prayer is about surrendering. So that I'm just going to focus on that for us for the next month. As we're in this sermon series of surrendering, our breakthrough prayer will be on surrendering. So allow me to pray for us. God, we cry out to you. Who else would hear our prayers? We pray to the God of Naomi, Ruth, and Boaz. We pray to the God of Obed, Jesse, David, and Jesus. We surrender our plans and hopes and dreams to make way for your plans, your hopes, your dreams for us, your people, your children, dearly loved by you. We surrender our wills, our preferences, our hearts, and we lay them on the altar. We surrender our time and our energy. We surrender all, that we might seek first your kingdom. Lord God, we are so grateful that we can come to you and surrender. Lord, we pray that you would guide us. We ask that you would help us surrender ourselves for your service and for your glory. Help us by the power of your Spirit to live into surrendering. Guide us by your Spirit. Break into our worlds. Break into our lives. Break through yet again into our hearts and into our churches. Again, work your wonders in our midst. And now, Lord God, we pray that you would encounter us. Encounter us now, Lord God, as we enter into silence and prepare our hearts to worship you, to surrender to you and you alone. Amen. I love our bells. We have a few announcements this morning. We had printed our guidelines, and I want you to review those. Get yourself comfortable. Think about what next Sunday is going to look like for you as it relates to these guidelines. And I wanted to mention this, that if next week when we go into the building, if you're still feeling uncomfortable, you can still be in your cars in the parking lot. We will still be transmitting over the radio. So we want you to know that, and we'll also continue to be live streaming. And then we would like to invite Renee to come as our chair of the Ad Council to share a few words about what it means for us to be meeting inside the church next Sunday.
Good morning. As we go inside church for services next week, you're going to see a few changes that we made. I want to thank Rick and Margie, Mike, Faye, for all the help that you did on last Wednesday when we met. We'll be using one door to enter the church and the same door to exit, and it'll be over on this end. That's my east, if I'm facing this way. You must wear a mask throughout the service. If you have a medical condition, just let the usher know that, and we'll try to seat you accordingly so you're kind of off a little bit to the side, so you won't be scared to be in our building. We'll still be live streaming, as Amy said. Ushers will take you into the church. We're going to have one route that everyone follows, so there's no miscommunication and people don't start meeting head on. Even though we wear masks, we still need to do our 6 feet apart. You may sit by others that you know and you are familiar being around. If they choose not to let you sit by them, please understand that. We're not going to judge anybody. As Amy said, we won't be able to sing any hymns, but she's come up with the humming, so that'll be fun. We've removed all the Bibles, the hymnals, pens, pencils, envelopes, everything from the church pews. And if we need to use anything, we do have our screen, and whatever we need to have people communicate with will be in the bulletin. So I welcome you back, and hopefully we can all make this work in a safe fashion. Thanks.
Thank you, Renee. Appreciate your words. There was a lot of things I had forgotten that she remembered, so it's going to take a couple weeks for us to get into our rhythms, and then after a while, I think we're just going to kind of forget how awkward this may feel at the very beginning. I think we're going to get past that rather quickly. I do need to tell you that Dent did an amazing job. They have set the bar very high for you, so I want you to be on your best behavior. There was no complaints. There was no mumbling, grumbling, grousing. They came in because they wanted to worship. They wanted to worship together. So I think we can make this work and we'll be just fine. So thank you, Renee, for that. Let us now turn to our joys and concerns and be in prayer for one another. I want to lift up the very critical concern for Donna and Neil Strawhorn and their daughter-in-law, Jen. So let us continue to pray for them and that family. Lord God, we pray for Jen. Her health is very critical as she's in the ICU. Lord God, we continue to pray for a miracle. We ask, Lord God, that you would heal her, that you would bring her through this and restore her to her family and to her husband. Lord God, we ask that by your Spirit, you would sustain this family that is going through a tremendous storm. Lord God, we pray that you would comfort them, that you would give them peace that passes all understanding. We pray, Lord God, that you would give them eyes to see those graced moments that you give throughout storms, because you are so good and so kind. Give them eyes to see how you are at work. Lord, in your mercy. And then, Lord God, we lift up a guy named Paul Buckley. He is in his final stages of life. Lord God, we know that you call us home. Every day is written before us, is written for us, and is written down in your book before we live a single day. So our time is in our is in your hands. You give us life and you call us home, and it's part of your plan for us. So Lord, we trust and entrust Paul into your care. You are calling him home. So Lord God, we ask for your grace in this transition. We pray for all those that love Paul and are near him. I pray that they would have a sense of the beautiful reality that this life is not all that there is. In fact, it is just a small little blip, for we are created to live with you eternally as we put our faith and hope in Christ. So I pray for that family to be strengthened in their faith, in their hope to be reunited with their loved one. I pray for peace, incredible peace, Lord God, as he passes. May it be smooth and gentle and gracious. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Is there anything else that we can be in prayer for one another? Any other prayer requests? Lord God, we pray with gratitude. We lift up this time. We thank you, Lord God, for your faithfulness to us. We've had amazing weather. This has been an incredible experience. It has been so much fun to pray outside. And I didn't know that would be the case. You have blessed us. You have encouraged us. You have built us up in our faith. And you still have work that you are doing. But so we just lift up in gratitude the season that we've had together outside. And we ask, Lord God, that your blessing would rest upon us and that you would continue to guide us powerfully by your Spirit as you lead us forward into the good plans you have for us. And all of God's children said, Amen. Amen. Now as we turn to our first hymn, we are safe now because we're still outside. We can pray, or we can sing out loud rather, hymn 419, I Am Thine, O Lord. I'll mention this now as we prepare ourselves for next week, that we will not be handing an offering plate around once we get inside the building. So we will strategically place an offering box as you come in, and you can drop off your offering as you come into the building, or you can drop it off as you exit, whatever is convenient for you. But now let us pray for our offering. God of Naomi and Ruth, God of Boaz, Obed, Jesse, David, and Jesus, God of good plans for us, receive our offering. Receive our very selves this morning. Receive our gifts as true expressions of worship, love, and devotion. Amen. Thank you. to the God who knows all things, to the God who has good plans for us. Take this offering, we pray, Lord God. Bless it. Multiply it. Multiply it and apply it to the lives of those who still need to experience the sweet joy of surrendering their hearts, their whole lives to you, O God. Amen.
I'm going to read the prayer of illumination. Dear Lord, break through into our hearts and minds as we grow in surrendering to you. Give us ears to hear and hearts to respond to the good plans you have for us, as revealed to us in your word and the story of Naomi, Ruth, and Boaz. Amen. Today's scripture reading is from Ruth 1, verses 1 through 9. In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land. So a man from Bethlehem in Judah, together with his wife and two sons, went to live for a while in the country of Moab. The name was Elimelech. His wife's name was Naomi, and names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephratites from Bethlehem, Judah, and they went to Moab and lived there. Now Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left with her two sons. They married Moabite women, one named Orpah and the other Ruth. After they had lived there about 10 years, both Mahlon and Chilion also died, and Naomi was left without her two sons and her husband. When Naomi heard in Moab that the Lord had come to the aid of his people by providing food for them, she and her daughters-in-law prepared to return home from there. With her two daughters-in-law, she left the place where she had been living and set out on the road that would take them back to the land of Judah. Then Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "Go back, each of you, to your mother's home. May the Lord show you kindness as you have shown kindness to your dead husbands and to me. May the Lord grant that each of you will find rest in the home of another husband." Then she kissed them goodbye, and they wept aloud. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Renee. Are you familiar with the term know-it-all? Someone who has an opinion about everything and maybe even sometimes knows a few things, but they're kind of jerks about it too. Maybe you knew one in school or in the workplace. This last weekend in Bemidji, one of my friends shared with me her brother is kind of a know-it-all. And I know that I thought I knew a lot when I was a teenager, like the rules that applied to me and the rules that were more like guidelines and the rules that didn't apply at all. But with each passing year, I know less and less. We are in a crazy world. But I do know one who does legitimately know it all. We worship the God who knows all things. I know the someone who created all the stars, and he calls them by name. I know the one who has numbered the hairs on our heads. And I think this helps us as we continue to press into this theme of surrendering. It helps us to know God knows us so intimately. Our God knows all secrets. They are like an open book before him. He sees clearly what is in the darkness. The psalmist proclaims and laments, "Surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me. But even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you." Our God knows what is going on in the world. He knows what's going to happen tomorrow. He knows what's going to happen 100 years from now. He knows the exact day and hour of the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. And God knows each of us. Psalm 139, verses 1 through 3, reminds us of the depth of God's knowledge of each one of us. The psalmist says, "You have searched me and you know me. You are familiar with all my ways. And before a word is on my tongue, you know it completely, O Lord." In the book of Job, "For his eyes are upon the ways of every person, and he sees their steps." And our God knows the good plans he has for my future and your future and our future. As we read from Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11, God declaring, "For I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." He knows all these things. He searches and knows each heart. He is the God who knows. And he is the God who has good plans for us. Remembering and being strengthened in these truths about who God is, it might be good for us to reflect on, especially as we're in hard times. As we are in these hard times, and as we struggle to, as we wrestle with surrendering, it might be good to remember these things about God. This is where having lived a little bit is helpful. If you've lived enough, and as you look back on your life, I've lived long enough now that I can look back on things that I could not see when I was younger because I was right in the middle of them, in the midst of them. But now I have a little perspective. This gray hair is here for a reason. Even though I was clear from the seventh grade up until my junior year of college that I wanted to be an English teacher, no doubt, God knew the plans that he had for me, and they are good. Even though I felt this call on my life that was weird and so very improbable to stand in this place and do this work, God knew. And God guided my steps. And God knew when he called my mother home that I would need new mothers. And God knew that when I had an estranged brother and a brother that passed away that I would need new siblings. And God knew that when my dad passed away that I would need to lean on God as my heavenly father in new and deeper ways. God knew, and he was ready. Psalm 86 reminds us of God's compassionate heart. God sets the lonely in families. And in Psalm 146, the Lord watches over the foreigner and sustains the fatherless. In Psalm 68, he is the father of the fatherless. Even when God's plans include sorrow and grief, they are good. Especially if we are given grace to see how our sorrows and grief are actually gracious invitations by God to surrender. Or when we can see this pandemic, when we can see the racial tension in our nation, when we can see the political upheaval as invitations to surrender, they are good. These are part of God's good plans. And I want to say this, I want to be very clear. As Christians, we do not surrender to issues or circumstances. We do not cave to circumstances that are beyond our control. No. As Christians, we surrender to the living God. God, who knows each and every one of us and holds our hearts tenderly in his hands.
With God's help, our struggles can be seen as a gift, because the struggle reveals who God is to us. As this poem so beautifully highlights for us this morning, because I just want to acknowledge that we are all grieving. We are all grieving what our church used to be. We're grieving what it is now. We're grieving what it will be, and it can't be all that we want it to be. We are all grieving. So this poem is for you. I received this beautiful book in the mail this week from a good friend. It is called The Cure for Sorrow by Jan Richardson. This is full of poems about grieving. And you know I'm in a season of grieving. And I found this poem and I felt like it was so appropriate for us. It is called For Our Family. When the shattering world, then your sheltering heart. When the sorrowing way, then your enduring grace. When the unbearable dark, then your comfort, your light. When the empty, the ache, then your welcoming door. When you, then this blessing, this grateful, this thanks. I think this poem underscores that there are some things about God that we cannot know, we cannot learn until we surrender, until we come to the end of ourselves. When we surrender in our grief, then we can have real lived experiences of God's sheltering heart, your encircling grace, O God, your light, your warmth, your love. This experience of God does not wipe away our grief or our pain, but knowing God this way, knowing that he knows us and has good plans for us, it can help us. It can make those losses more bearable, and it can bring healing and hope. As we follow this thread of loss and grief, it leads us to a story in our Bibles that I hope is familiar with you. Do you remember the book of Ruth? It begins with a woman who loses her homeland, then she loses her husband, then she loses two sons. She feels like she has lost her God, and now she's about to lose both of her daughters-in-law. This is a story that starts out with a tremendous amount of grief and loss, loss upon loss, grief stacked upon grief. But Naomi, Ruth, and Boaz and their little community, Bethlehem, are about to learn big life lessons of the God who knows and the God who has good plans for us. See, God knew Naomi's heart. God knew Naomi's heart was hardened with bitterness. He knew that she believed God had taken away everything from her. God could see that Ruth's heart harbored this puzzling spiritual hunger and a woman's desire to hold her own baby in her arms. God knew that Boaz's heart harbored a strong desire to provide for a family, to protect, to leave a godly legacy. God knew all of these hearts. And God knew how much the world needed a Savior, way before we knew we needed a Savior. And he worked out the coming of this Savior through the line and lineage of Ruth and Boaz. God knew and he had good plans for them. God knew and he has good plans for us, all of us. I like how Laura Story wrote about this, the book of Ruth. This is the book that I'm using for our sermon series for the next month. It's called I Give Up. It's a wonderful resource, a really good book. Every chapter is a nuanced a wrestling with surrendering, coming at it from a lot of different angles. Came to me at a very important part, time in my life where I needed to engage with those truths. I like how she talks about the book of Ruth, the book of Ruth. So when Naomi learned that God had provided for her hometown food so that they might survive in this famine that had taken over big chunks of the world, she decided to return home, but without her two daughters-in-law. Her comment to them was, "It is exceedingly bitter for me, for your sake, that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me." And later she commented, "Do not call me Naomi, but Mara," which means bitterness, "for the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. I went away full, but now the Lord has brought me back empty." She wasn't putting on a happy face. She saw God as 100% responsible for her circumstances, and her circumstances were not good. So was Naomi overreacting? We need to remember that in her culture, she had lost everything. She had lost a husband to provide for her. She lost her sons that could provide for her. There was no heir to provide for her. She had no hopes of providing for herself, and it seemed like God had forgotten her. And then take Ruth. It didn't make sense, but she was all in with Naomi's God. She called on the name of Yahweh. She hadn't seen God's goodness per se or understood his character, but she was moving forward in faith. When they arrived in Bethlehem, they didn't even recognize Naomi because the years had been so hard on her. And yet the first chapter of this hard story ends with a sentence full of promise. When we read, "They came to Bethlehem at the beginning of the barley harvest." The series of events that unfold for Naomi and Ruth and Boaz, they're unbelievable. Except for the God who was working behind the scenes in ways they could not understand or see right away, to bring forth his good plans for them, for all of them. Ruth just happened to start gleaning in Boaz's field. Naomi just happened to remember that Boaz was a kinsman. He was family. There was a glimmer of hope, of provision. Boaz just happened to see Ruth in his fields. And then he instructed his men to watch out for her, not to humiliate her, to actually make gleaning easier for her, to pull out some of the stalks from the bundles that they had gathered, pull out some of the stalks and lay them out so that she can pick those up. Boaz provided for their hunger and for Ruth's dignity. I think it takes faith. I think it takes incredible inner strength to see God's little moments of grace and goodness and to receive them as gifts in the midst of storms. In the middle of dark times, to be able to see these things. But this story reminds us that it's possible. It is possible in a storm, in dark times, to see the glimmers of God's grace and his activity. Naomi saw glimmers. Ruth saw glimmers. Boaz saw glimmers. Your prayers for my dad? For my dad and I, it helped me see God's glimmers of grace and goodness and to receive them as gifts in the middle of a storm. And as I share my experiences of when I felt God being active and present, when I share those stories with others, then those people I share with, they too can see the glimmers of God's grace in the midst of a storm. God's goodness and his good plans unfolding for me. But this is not the end. This is not the end of the story for Boaz and Ruth. They didn't just get married and live happily ever after. They had a child. They had a son. They named him Obed. He was Naomi's joy in her latter years, in her old age. Obed, remember, is the father of Jesse. And Jesse is the father of David. That David. King David. And when we turn to the Gospel of Matthew, 28 generations later, Jesus Christ is born of Mary and Joseph in Bethlehem of the lineage of David, Obed, Jesse, Ruth, and Boaz. And the hunger of the world was given a Savior, Jesus, the bread of life. Because God knows what we need, and he brings about good in our lives. As I conclude, I am surprised at how hard it is sometimes to write sermons. Grief does not help, but either does doubt. And sometimes I have to write about these things when my faith feels weak and thin. God, I believe, but help me with my unbelief. And when I wonder if God knows my needs, if God cares, if God sees, if God is active in my life, when I wonder, this story helps me, and it eases my anxiety, and it helps me surrender to God. We sometimes accuse God of being distant, aloof, coming late to the party, and basically being indifferent and unkind. But he is none of these. He doesn't just know all things. He knows us. He knows each of our hearts. And he knows our deepest desires. And he has good planned for us. Good that will help us thrive and enjoy life. Not only does he give us hope for the future, but also brings about that future that he helped us hope in. As we prepare for our future together, because we will, we are, we need to, we will step into the good plans that God has for us. God knows the plans he has for us to help us flourish, to thrive. He does not want to tear us down or harm us. He is not tricking us. He is not teasing us. God desires to give us hope and give us things to look forward to as a faith community. We are not down and out. We are up and coming because our God is good. Cling to this truth. As we go forward, I need you all to cling to this truth. Set aside your doubt. Set aside your fear. Let go of the history. Let go of the past and cling to God because we are moving forward. We have good plans that we have to walk into. Why wouldn't we do this and do this together? We can trust our Heavenly Father to do what is right for us here in Vergas. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Therefore, it is possible. It is necessary. It is good. It is the call and the challenge for us right now to surrender. It is possible because he is good. He is the God of all of who we are. Will you allow me to pray for us as we close? Dear God, we wave our flags of surrender. We pray that any resistance in us, fear and doubt and anxiety and laziness, whatever, Lord God, we pray that it would melt away. The God of Naomi and Ruth. And from our own lived experience, we celebrate that you do know all things and that you have good planned for us. Give us strength to cling to these truths about you, to cling tenaciously to you in trust. We can trust you with our timing. We can surrender to your love and be confident that you will receive our surrender and honor it and lead us forward into plans to prosper us and not to harm us, plans to give us a hope and a future. Amen and amen. As an expression of our surrender, let us turn to hymn 399. Let us sing this prayerfully. Take my life and let it be. Yes, Lord. Let us now close with our final hymn, the surrendering to the blessing of the community, to one another and to God, as we sing, God be with you. To surrender concretely. I invite you to take up the challenge that is before us to engage in prayer twice a day. You can do it. Let us do it together. Let us be unified in prayer It will guide us into God's good plans for us. So make it a habit. Let us pray twice a day for God to break through in ways that we can't do. Pray that God will break through in our midst and again do wonders for us, His good plans for us. And now, dear friends, receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. Amen and amen. God bless.